And Grizzly Boone has Miss Fantasy. He scoops her up. Oh, he gives her a big old kiss. He said if she interfered, he'd give her a big old kiss right on the lips. And he did it. Ho, ho, ho.
Welcome to Pro Wrestling This Week. I'm Gordon Solie.
I'm Joe Pedicino.
Joe, how were things in Los Angeles?
They were terrific, Gordon. We were out there as the guest of our station in L.A., KCOP. We want to thank all of our wrestling viewers who are watching us this morning on Channel 13 in L.A. for showing up for the City of Los Angeles Marathon. Just another example of how in Los Angeles, KCOP is number one. And Gordon, we're going to start off in Dallas, Texas.
We are indeed. We'll be journeying to Dallas, Texas in just a moment. We'd like to point out that our Matt Classic this week goes back to 1971. We're going to see a Continental Tag Team Championship match. Also, we'll be going to the Great Northwest, and our international match takes place in Puerto Rico. But now, let's go to Dallas, Texas, where we have a most unusual situation, if you will. We have a referee wrestling a manager. You heard me correctly, a referee wrestling a manager. Watch now as David Manning takes on Gary Hart.
Gary is bargaining for a submission here. And the fans begin to chant for David Manning.
Take it by the tight.
David reaches around and grabs Hart. Locks up the head, but he may be hurting himself in the process. Manning breaks free from the leg. He's still got the headlock on Gary Hart. This crowd of wrestling Star Wars is getting their money's worth. What a fabulous night of talent and action. And this special feature bout is just a part of it. A struggle from one rope to the other, each man on his feet. A shot by Hart. David breaks free, and he's beginning to get pretty angry. The arrogance of Gary Hart may work against him. Manning is getting teed off here. He backs the referee away. This is still anybody's bout, even though Hart's had the better half thus far. There's David. A shot to the face, to the midsection of the face again. Here's David climbing up on the ropes, holding Gary Hart helpless there. And David Manning is biting, I think, on the ear. And this crowd loves it. Hart goes down and out of the ring. Now Gary Hart has reached over. He's grabbed the mic. David Manning doesn't know he has it. And he hits David across the head with the mic. Gary grabbed the mic. David didn't know he had it. And David now is down. He got things going, and Hart used the mic. Gary Hart back in the driver's seat now on David Manning. He's got him, and he's going to throw him from the ropes. It's a clothesline. Could be lights out. One. Oh, wait a minute. Gary Hart just got off of him and shakes his finger. And Rick Hazard and says, oh no, I want more. There's Gary Hart throwing Rick Hazard to the floor. Gary Harding is showing us the same stuff tonight that he's shown us ever since Abdullah Christmas night. Here's Red River Jack. Red River Jack has come out, has slammed Gary Hart, and now runs away, and I'm not sure Gary even knows what happened. David Manning leaps on top, but there's no referee. God, Gary Hart does not know what hit him.
The Butcher, you've got to watch this guy at all times.
I'm Walt Davis, the Chevy man in Elk Grove. I sincerely believe we have the very best buys in new and used cars and trucks in the Sacramento Valley. We have salespeople who are here to help, not push.
Well, David Manning gets the pinfall, but not without some help as pro wrestling continues, Joe.
That's right. Gary Hart's viewpoint this week, a special interview with Gary and Bill Mercer. They're at ringside in Dallas, Texas, when a surprise guest shows up.
As we promised just a moment ago, we've got a surprise for you, because I wanted to find out a little bit more about what is in the future between you and David Manning. And so David Manning is coming down here to talk.
Look you here. There he is.
All right. Look you here. Now, he says, you know what happened. Red River Jack interfered. What's your feeling about this?
Yeah, I think people saw the tape. They also saw Gary Hart hit me in the head with a microphone when the pendulum had changed and everything was in my favor all of a sudden.
You know what bothers me? That it wasn't a hammer. So I wouldn't be looking at your face today. You know well as I do, if it hadn't been for Bruiser Brody dressed up as Red River Jack, you wouldn't even be standing here today. I'd knock you out anytime I want, little man, and you remember that.
All right, the words are fine, but what else?
Why don't we just quit beating around the bush? Ed Watt's been telling me you're back there running your mouth again. Why don't you just tell me where we're going from here?
Well, if you have the guts, I would like to give you another chance at me. You say you want me so bad. Why don't you just get yourself, tape up your little fist, wear cowboy boots, wear whatever you want, and get in the ring with me one more time with one stipulation only. Just one stipulation. What do you think of that?
I'm listening.
No Red River Jack in the building that night. Just you and me.
All right, let me tell you something, Hart. I don't need Red River Jack. You know, you use the microphone. Let's just put it this way. You want to do that? This time, though, when I get to the ring, I'm going to come fighting. There's not going to be any jumping me from behind and taking over on me and beating me up before we ever get started. I'll come to the ring fight. You want a street fight? We'll have a street fight. I don't care what it's at.
I'm going to smack your face until your nose bleeds, yeah. You punk.
You go ahead. That's exactly what he did last time, Billy. He ran his mouth. You see him leaving this time. He was looking at me. He wants a street fight. He wants to tape the fist. I'll be ready this time, Gary Hart. And as soon as we step in the ring, we start fighting. No more ifs, ands, or buts.
All right. Thank you, David.
Something tells me we can look forward to that street match coming up here on Pro Wrestling This Week in the coming weeks. Right now, we're going to go back to Detroit, Michigan in 1971. Abdullah the Butcher, a strong force in the wrestling world in those days, as he is today. And he takes on Gil Guerrero in this week's Matt Classic, here on Pro Wrestling This Week.
Gil Guerrero from Mexico and around ringside, lurking dangerously close to the action. You probably can pick up on his confidant. There he is in the corner of your screen, James J. Dillon. The troublemaker, Dillon, the controversial manager of Abdullah the Butcher. The Butcher, every single move he makes is lethal. His hands are lethal weapons. He's a karate judo master. His feet are lethal weapons also. He's one of the strongest men in professional wrestling. And there was an example of that karate, or what could be karate. The Butcher backing Guerrero into the corner. Horrible sight to watch, but that is the way of Abdullah the Butcher. That's the way this guy is. An international wrestling superstar with a headbutt knocks Gil Guerrero now out of the ring. Abdullah the Butcher looking extremely confident, very pleased with himself. And what he's done to Gil Guerrero. Abdullah the Butcher has ended the... Now watch Dillon on the corner. Now watch Dillon on the floor. Dillon has got Guerrero, threw him back into the ring. Dillon threw Guerrero back into the ring. The Butcher, you've got to watch this guy at all times. You might think you've got him. As you people have noticed who've seen him before, you might think you've gotten him beat. But then from out of nowhere, he'll come up with a fist, a karate chop, or whatever that'll just knock you right off your feet, knock the wind right out of you. Abdullah the Butcher. an expert at trickery in the ring. A real expert. And what a dangerous, dangerous wrestler he is. No doubt about it. Look at all the careers of wrestlers that he has ended through the years. In demand all over the world. In demand from wrestlers. Wrestlers who want the Butcher in the ring, who will do anything, give anything to meet Abdullah the Butcher in the ring. There it is, the Sudanese meat cleaver. This is probably it. This has got to be it. Guerrero is gone. Oh, now, wait a minute. The Butcher pulls him up. Only a two count. Yes, Dillon, the manager, you see him, calling for one more time. This is just like a hatchet coming down across the throat of Guerrero, that Sudanese meat cleaver, as he calls it. The two count goes in. Dillon signaling, yes. But still, the Butcher will not release Gil Guerrero. The Butcher will not release Guerrero yet. We're going to stay with the action as long as the Butcher continues to act in this way. We're going to stay with the action. Dillon trying to get the Butcher off, not having too much success. Finally, the Butcher does step back, knocks Guerrero out of the ring with a great deal of disdain.
Well, a very impressive victory for Abdullah the Butcher. And you know, Gordon, isn't it amazing that 16 years ago, Abdullah was such a strong force in wrestling, and here we are in 1987, and he's still one of the major forces in wrestling today.
He seems to be one of those who's going to go on forever, becoming a legend in his own time. By the way, that was J.J. Dillon who was managing in that particular situation. We've got a young fellow that we want to take a look at right now. His name is Sky-Hi Lee. He's up in the Northwest, up in Portland, Oregon. We're going to watch Sky-Hi Lee as he wins a controversial second fall in this match against Mike Miller.
Sky High with an arm whip.
Ooh, right into that other turnbuckle. And then he nails Mike Miller with an elbow as Miller came off the turnbuckle. And Sky High Lee was right there. One, two, and Miller kicks out.
Sky almost put that one away. He almost put this main event away with that move right there. Forearm smash across the back of the neck by Sky High Lee. Another smash across the back. And face first into the turnbuckle goes the face of Mike Miller. Miller driving a knee into the midsection of Sky-Hi Lee. And that took a breath out of him. And now Miller getting something going again. Going to use that top rope. Whiplash. Just whips Sky-Hi Lee off that top rope. Not only chokes him, but just, again, takes the breath right out of him. And now Miller coming up behind him again. Going to roll him over. And he's got him hooked in there, and he's using the trunks. But he's using the trunks right in front of the referee. So that didn't work out too well. Mike Miller getting a little anxious out there, as he knows time is going to become a factor here very soon. And he also knows that he's down one fall. We mentioned a little earlier that the new WrestleMedia is out, and you want to get your copy. If you're in the Portland area, you get a copy at Rich's Cigar Store in downtown Portland, or at the old Milwaukee Pizza Factory on the Gotham Boulevard in the Oak Grove area. Or you can certainly write, subscribe, get information on subscribing to the WrestleMedia. Address your letter to Post Office Box 17202, Portland, Oregon, 97217, WrestleMedia. Did he get him? Did he get him? He got him. Oh, no, he didn't. No, no, he just got to the second count. Yeah. Sky-Hi Lee got him now.
Pro Wrestling This Week continues now, and may I offer an editorial comment? I have a hunch we're going to be seeing a lot more of Sky-Hi Lee in the years to come. Now, let's go to New York City. In the offices of Pro Wrestling Illustrated, we're going to hear first from Craig Peters. He's going to bring us the nation's top 10 women wrestlers and then the ratings for the WCCW. Also, Bill Apter, senior editor, has an interesting editorial comment. Craig?
This is Craig Peters, associate editor of Pro Wrestling Illustrated Magazine. Bill Apter is off preparing for his special segment on the Fabulous Freebirds. In the meantime, we're going to take a look at the ratings for the top 10 women in the sport, and we're going to take a look at the world-class area. First, let's take a look at PWI's top 10 women list. And now let's take a look at the top 10 wrestlers in the world-class area.
Michael Hayes, Buddy Roberts, Terry Gordy, the Fabulous Freebirds. I've just been sitting here reviewing our March 1987 edition in which the fans voted Terry Gordy the most improved wrestler of the year. Look at this. Over 13,000 votes for Terry Gordy. Michael Hayes, let me tell you something. I've been watching your PS rumors, and I really don't care what you say about me, what you say about my family, what you say about my hair. It's not important. Our magazines, Pro Wrestling Illustrated, Inside Wrestling, The Wrestler, have been more than fair to you and the Fabulous Freebirds. You shouldn't have any gripes about us. In the meantime, you know what you guys have done? You're not smacking me in the face by telling me anything about my hair or anything. You have smacked in the face over 13,000 fans who voted for Gordy as the most improved wrestler. Okay, Michael Hayes? And that really stinks in my book. Let me tell you something. Michael, this is far from over. Until you people can see your way clear to apologize to the fans of the United States of America. Again, Michael Hayes, you and your guys are pure sleaze. For Pro Wrestling Illustrated, this is Bill Apter. See you next time.
Comments from Bill Apter about the Freebirds. And that brings us to our UWF Ring Report. This week, a very unique look at the Universal Wrestling Federation Tag Team Tournament that was held recently in Fort Worth. Barry Johnson on our staff here at Pro Wrestling This Week put it to music. It's Eye of the Tiger by Survivor. Let's take a look at that UWF Tag Team Tournament. We'll be right back.
Nice piece of business by Barry, no question about that. And Joe, lots more coming up.
That's right. We're going to go back to the UWF with P.S. Rumors and Michael Hayes right after we take a timeout.
Stand this week that Michael Hayes' P.S. Rumors are not rumors.
Not at all, Gordon. This week it comes to us again from the World of Wheels in Atlanta, Georgia. And this time it's pure fact. Right, Michael?
All right. Welcome again to the hottest thing on pro wrestling this week, which is P.S.'s Rumors. And this week we have no rumors. All we have is facts. And the facts is that the UWF is going everywhere and taking every place. We are going to L.A. We are going to Minneapolis. We are going to Milwaukee. We are going to Philadelphia. We are going to Columbus, Georgia. But the main thing is we are coming back home to Atlanta, GA. Okay, and right now, I know last week everybody had my opinions and my feelings on coming to Atlanta. But Sunshine, there's so many men out here. I mean, men, do y'all want to know how Sunshine feels? She feels good, but they want to know how you feel about coming to Atlanta.
Well, first off, if you want to start with Atlanta men, I'm sorry, Michael, but I must say I'm very impressed. And I love the South. Dang, it's good to be in your home. And I must say that Michael has shown me one heck of a time. Thank you very, very,
very much.
Well, it's certainly nice to see the rather ambitious schedule of the UWF. And may I just say that as far as I'm concerned, Joe, they're certainly going to restore the wrestling tradition to the Olympic Auditorium in the City of Angels.
That's right. You know, Gordon, March 27th is going to be a big night for the fans in Los Angeles as the UWF does return wrestling major league level to the Olympic Auditorium there in L.A. Now, speaking of major league wrestling, it's time for our feature match of the week. It takes place in Birmingham, Alabama, Continental Championship Wrestling. The tag team titles are on the line as the Nightmares, the current champions, defend those belts against the Dirty White Boy and Jerry Stubbs. Gordon Soley was there and called the action in this terrific tag team title match.
Off the ropes, caught him right across the pectoralis majors. Not enough yet, though. Tony Anthony a bit too quick. Once again, there's that bottom wrist lock and a lateral drop into a head scissors. And the crowd continues to clap and shout its approval of the Nightmares in this Continental Tag Team Championship match. Titles on the line. Up and Ripped up. Over that top rope, and he's got problems. Nightmare outside the ring. Man. He flew through the air. He had to hit the ground at about 45 miles an hour. Now the second Nightmare trying to get in there, and he's complaining about the ring ropes. In the meanwhile, Stubbs getting in some cheap shots outside the ring. Helping the other, trying to get him back into the ring, but he has been hurt. No question about that. Hit that concrete. High backdrop once again, and he's got a lot of problems. All right, and so Tony Anthony keeps the pressure on him. Tony Anthony keeps the pressure on the Nightmare. And so, the Nightmare now in a lot of trouble as Stubbs continues to put the boots to it. And the Nightmare trying to get it together is caught by Tony Anthony, the Dirty White Boy. Now Stubbs drives a knee into the abdominal wall.
This Continental Tag Team Championship match will continue right after we pause.
If you're looking for a used truck, you better come to Worthington Chevrolet. We've got hundreds and hundreds.
Wait a minute. We've got all four of them in there. And
let's return to our tag team title match in Continental Championship Wrestling.
Good move by the Nightmare. Has Tony Anthony in trouble. But it's taking its toll on the Nightmare. No question about that. Jerry Stubbs tries to charge over. The tag is made, and now the Nightmare has Jerry Stubbs in the corner. And now catches Tony Anthony coming in. High back drop by the Nightmare. Beautiful flying drop kick. And the Nightmare dispatching this team of the Dirty White Boy and Jerry Stubbs. Brother, he is punishing him. Now Stubbs rakes it. Aha! Stubbs over the top rope onto the timer's table. And now it's the Nightmare's turn to be two on one, if you will, but they back away, sportsmen that they are. Started to go for a gut wrench, has him up now for a pile driver. And the second Nightmare hurtling across the ring. Stubbs catches him from behind. Wait a minute. Oh, my. Anthony is out. Jerry Stubbs managed to throw his arm over him. That is hardly kosher, but in view of everything, it looks like he got by with it. It looks like he got by with it. Tony Anthony being dragged out by Jerry Stubbs. They've got the belts, and so it looks to me like we do have indeed new Continental Tag Team Champions. Let's get the official word.
Ladies and gentlemen, your winners and new Continental Tag Team Champions, the team of Jerry Stubbs and the Dirty White Boy.
Well, a tremendous disappointment for the Nightmares, but I'll guarantee you, no matter where it takes place, those Nightmares will get those titles back.
I can imagine they'll be trying very hard. Gordon, it's time right now for our WWF report, and this week it's a rundown on WrestleMania plus a major contract signing. Let's go right now to WrestleMania rundown. Of course, the first match, one of the most important matches, is the match between Rowdy Piper and Adrian Adonis. Rumors throughout the WWF now that it will be a hair versus hair match. Two interesting six-man tag team matches, a mixed six-man. King Kong Bundy and two midgets going up against Hillbilly Jim and two midgets. And the rules in this one, very, very peculiar. It must be midget versus midget or big man versus big man. Cannot be mixed. The other six-man tag match, the Hart Foundation, including Danny Davis, takes on the British Bulldogs and their partner, Tito Santana, and that match also with some special stipulations. Now, a new match added just this week. Let's go to Gene Okerlund for the news on this latest match added to WrestleMania 3.
This is the WrestleMania Report. I'm Gene Okerlund. Surprise! Yes, yet even another match has been added to WrestleMania 3. Because of what happened recently in the snake pit between the Honky Tonk Man and Jake the Snake Roberts, challenge exchanges have been made and the match has been signed. Now even bigger, better and badder, WrestleMania 3. A grand total of 12 exciting matches. The Honky Tonk Man with Jimmy the Mouth of the South Hart in his corner to meet Jake Roberts. And in the Snake's corner, no, not Damien, but a man very familiar with snakes, none other than rock sensation Alice Cooper. It should be something else.
So the Honky Tonk Man will be facing Jake the Snake Roberts at WrestleMania 3. And big news, Alice Cooper in the corner of Jake the Snake Roberts. Now, the main event, of course, Andre the Giant against Hulk Hogan. This week, the formal contract signing finally took place. Let's go now to the signing of the contract between Andre and Hulk.
gave this man an opportunity. Now he's got that opportunity.
Sign it if you're gonna sign it.
Sign under his name, Strogan.
I'll sign a lot of things, sign a lot of contracts. I never thought it would come to this. Thought it was you, man. But it's both of you. You're both sick. You're both sick. If you wanted a title shot, all you had to do was ask me. I'd have gave you anything, man. Andre, you were bigger than the world title to me. Yeah, I'll sign it. I'm gonna get your attention too in WrestleMania. When you tore my shirt off, man, when you tore the cross, you tore the heart and soul out of all the little hulksters, man. Not just me. We're gonna get your attention, man. Yeah, we're gonna get your attention.
We told you that the Honky Tonk Man was going to be facing Jake the Snake Roberts. Let's go to Imagine Now, where he warms up for the Snake. He's going to be in the ring against Jerry Monty. We're going to show you at the end of that match that shake, rattle, and roll.
Yes, indeed, a Honky Tonk trying to set up Jerry Monty. Monty off the rope, and unfortunately runs into an elbow of the Honky Tonk Man.
You know, he's got a nice rhythm to his moves in the ring. His moves are very musically inclined, I think.
There'll be a ringing in Jake the Snake's ears for some time, that's for sure. Monty, head first to the buckle. The Honky Tonk Man all over Jerry Monty. Early on, of course, we heard from the Hillbilly. Hillbilly Jim, look at that clothesline, huh? Nicely executed, I might add.
Very nice.
Hillbilly on his way to the beautiful Pontiac Silverdome. Uh-oh, look out, here comes Shake, rattle, and roll! Out to the canvas, Jerry Monty. And a two and a three count. Not surprisingly here, the Honky Tonk Man gets the two.
Out there, never attempt any of this dangerous halt.
Now to Memphis, Tennessee, and Southern Professional Wrestling as we watch Jerry Lawler in action. Jerry Lawler, recently returned from the injured list, is back in full swing again. Now let's see him against Boy Tony.
Tony wants to be declared the winner here. He said, hey, he hit me with a fist, and you should disqualify him immediately, referee. Referee Calhoun had to have warned Lawler about using the fist already. Oh.
Waiting the right hand. Tony popped him a good one, but Lawler came right back and blasted him on.
Is that all Jerry Lawler knows how to do is punch? Is that all he knows how to do is punch? I'm sick of turning a fist. He don't know how to do nothing but punch. He can't wrestle. He should be a boxer. I'm sick of the fist. I'm tired of the fist. He's a Muhammad Ali of Jerry Lawler. I'm sick of it.
You're not nearly as tired of it as Boy Tony is, Bruno. Oh, they got the weasel chant going.
Drops down, the fist was doubled again, and again, the referee is warning him about it.
Third time it's been on Jerry about using that fist.
We have passed the 5-minute mark in this one. Lawler, Boy Tony. With Downtown Bruno in Boy Tony's corner. Oh! Another mistake by Boy Tony. Lawler moved, and Tony's fist was just rammed right into the mat.
And he was hammering, too. Yeah. He was really going to hammer. One fall, 10-minute time limit match. Boy Tony and Jerry the King Lawler.
Oh, look out. Bruno from outside with a choke on the King. After Boy Tony had hit him with a fist.
asking for it, Bruno.
Lawler hit again by the right fist. Boy, Tony. Ooh, he really unloaded on him that time. Another right hand. Look out.
Comes the strap.
Trips it. Look out. Boy, Tony drops down. Lawler had moved. Whoa.
We said you were asking for it, Bruno. Sunset clip. Lawler's got him. 2, 3. Yeah.
And gets him, but look out. The last.
Well, it was an unconventional victory for the King, but they all count in the record book. Right now, it's time to go to our international match of the week. It's in Puerto Rico, and TNT the Ninja is going to take on a fellow by the name of Steve Blackman. Now, in the corner of TNT is the Mask Professor. Let's go to our international match of the week.
Behind that devastating style, also having in his side the advice of that strange mask manager with a tuxedo outside the ring, the Mask Professor. So far, TNT undefeated. Good takedown by Steve Blackman. Used all his strength, and there goes TNT right back on Steve Blackman. He was very impressive last time we saw him on Caribbean Championship Wrestling. And even though this man is a bigger man than he is, he's still taking care of Blackman.
That's right. You know, the thing about this man, TNT, is he doesn't give you a chance to stop and think. He's perpetual motion in there. It's like a poetry, man. He just flows. He never stops. He doesn't give you a chance to think about any counters or any moves that you're going to make before you have time to reel from one punch. He's laying another side kick or something else on you. He's right there. He wears a man down quick, Hugo.
There is TNT, the Ninja Wrestler, going straight at it, choking, direct choking. The referee should come in and break it up. Oh, there it is. He was being distracted by the Mask Professor outside the ring. I was wondering how come he didn't break the hold, but he was occupied with the manager. Once again, I don't know about you, Ron, but I think this Mask Manager, besides just distracting the referees, you think by any chances he might be the guy that taught him all this martial arts and stuff?
Only time will tell there. You know, I've listened to him talk in the dressing room a couple of times, and I've heard TNT ask him questions about maneuvers and things, and I've seen this Mask Manager come right up and show him. So you may have a real good thing there, Hugo. You know, maybe this man is another karate expert. I don't know for sure, but I know they are very, very close, and TNT listens to him. Look, there it is, the dreaded Cobra hold. This is the man's finishing hold. I imagine it's Katie Bar the door from here.
The Cobra, full impact on Steve Blackman. And for you kids out there, never attempt any of this dangerous holds. It could be deadly. TNT, the Ninja Wrestler, has just defeated Steve Blackman. His manager, the Professor, comes in. And here's the mystery, Ron. Now, they put the cover, that blanket or whatever, on top of him. And nobody will get to see how he gets Blackman back into control of his actions again. Here is TNT. He sticks the hand. Maybe he pushes on one of the arteries or something, the nerves, and there he is, victorious TNT.
What a match indeed.
Yes, big match by TNT, and very strange with that Mask Professor at ringside. Gordon, right now it's time to go to the Deep South.
It is indeed, and let's journey now to Atlanta, Georgia, where we're going to watch Mike Golden take on Grizzly Boone. Now, Mike Golden is managed, of course, by Miss Fantasy, and well, you're going to see some unusual interference. We're in Atlanta. Take it away.
Golden backs him into the corner, fires him into the other turnbuckle. Comes charging in, big shoulder to the midsection. And right now, Grizzly Boone, whoa! That big left hand on top of the head. Whoa, and there goes Mike Golden's head into the top turnbuckle. And it looks as if Grizzly Boone may turn the tide here, Rock.
Grizzly Boone is upset.
He's got him in the corner. Whoa! He whipped him out of that corner. Mike Golden high into the air and down on that back, and now Grizzly Boone is fired up. He fires him off the ropes, hits him with a big elbow. Drops Mike Golden down to the canvas. Grizzly Boone starting to make his move.
He must have trouble seeing, Nick, because he's moving in a little too slow.
I know
a wrestler like Mike Golden, with his experience, will be up and back on him again.
Well, it looks as if Miss Fantasy's trying to pull Golden out of the ring. There goes Boone, stepping through, reaching to grab him. Oh! Ooh, a slap right in the face.
Now, Grizzly ought to pay attention.
A slap right in the face.
Grizzly had better pay attention to what's going on in the ring. He's being counted. Now, Miss Fantasy is in the ring.
Well, Grizzly's right after. She's trying to get Mike up. Uh-oh, she may have bitten. Uh-oh, she trips over Golden. And Grizzly Boone has Miss Fantasy. He scoops her up. Oh, he gives her a big old kiss. He said if she interfered, he'd give her a big old kiss right on the lips. And he did it. Oh, Miss Fantasy gets kicked. Whoa, and here's the Nightmares.
Now it's going to be 3-on-1, unfortunately.
The Nightmares are on Grizzly Boone. He didn't see him coming from behind. Mike Golden's starting to get to his feet. He's back on his feet now. Oh, they've got Grizzly Boone down. Miss Fantasy's in there directing that traffic. The Nightmares
holding him down. And here goes Mike Golden down to the top row.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Here he goes.
This is the only way they could do anything to hurt Grizzly Boone, I'll tell you right now.
Well, 3-on-1. Ooh! A big knee right across the throat of Grizzly Boone. Now they switch.
Wait a minute. Now they're
going to
do
a chain reaction going here, it looks like. Ooh! Now the Nightmare comes off. Look, the other Nightmare shoots up. They've got a chain reaction going. They're trying to put Grizzly Boone out of professional wrestling. Oh, that's 3 big knees off the ropes. If anyone in the back can hear this monitor, please come out. Grizzly, oh, you see the blood coming from Grizzly Boone right now. The 3 men are all over him. Here comes some help from the back. Here comes Don Sanders, Glenn Holbrook, Granger Ross, Greg Brown, Greg Evans, a whole host of wrestlers, Steve Lawler, and the Nightmares and Mike Golden and Miss Fantasy. They beat a hasty retreat when some help comes along.
Well, you know, Miss Fantasy said the Nightmares were going to have to prove themselves. And unfortunately for Grizzly Boone, this evidently is how they decided to do it.
Hey, Carol, did you hear the news about...
Oh, don't tell me. I've already heard enough news. My brain is on tilt.
Yeah, but that's the point. Weekday mornings from 7 till 9. Instead of news, you can relax with laughter watching Mr. Ed, the Addams Family, McHale's Navy, and Dobie Gillis all on TV 58.
Now that's good news.